Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Harold Holzer, and I have the privilege of serving as director of Roosevelt House. And I'm thrilled to welcome all of you, and honored and thrilled to welcome Professor William Leuchtenburg for this conversation about his amazing new book about the American presidency in the 20th century. So welcome, Bill.
Thanks, Harold.
And as a reminder of how he not only interprets, but literally straddled the century, you were born during the Harding administration. You listened to Roosevelt's, FDR's acceptance speech at from the 1932 Democratic Convention on the radio. Not to mention the brilliant dissection he has provided, an interpretation of Roosevelt over the years in books that, I mean, I'm no baby, but I read them when I was a young man. And they were so important and influential for me. Franklin D. Roosevelt and the New Deal is such a classic, deservedly so. So not to waste time and talk and not give Professor Leuchtenburg a chance, I did... I had to start by showing you all a photograph. Actually, if we can get it on the screen, it's from the last time I got together with Professor Leuchtenburg, only 25 years ago. So there we. So I had just written a book with Mario Cuomo called Lincoln on Democracy. And Professor Leuchtenburg was assigned by American Heritage magazine to go to Albany in the governor's helicopter, right? With just us.
That is correct. Yeah.
And interview him about the new book and his interest in Lincoln. And we took along a young intern from American Heritage, who you see here, who grew up to be Sam Sifton, who was the dining critic of the New York Times. And the food editor. He did pretty well from the experience.
Yeah.
One more picture from that, and then I'll begin. So, here we are in the Red Room, which is the official governor's chamber, which, of course, FDR used as governor. And Mario Cuomo is standing on a shelf that comes out of the ceremonial desk. Can anyone guess why that shelf is there? It has nothing to do with FDR. Short people, but who? No, Dewey. Dewey. Dewey wanted to look tall in his photograph, so he would pull out the shelf. And that's what he was demonstrating for us that day. What I'd like to do this evening is do this chronologically and hope we get as far as Professor Leuchtenburg did. And you start, of course, with Theodore Roosevelt at the beginning of the 20th century. A combination, you remind us, of St. Vitus and St. Paul. Was he pure act as Mr. Lincoln's private secretary and FDR's Secretary of State John Hay said, or more? How should we judge him?
Oh, certainly was pure act, and he was regarded as someone who never really grew up. One of his cabinet officials said to him that your friends have great hopes for you when you grow up. And this was when he was president of the United States. Gifford Pinchot, the famous forester, conservationist, first encountered Theodore Roosevelt when he was governor in Albany. And he came he was to be an overnight guest. And he came upon a scene where various marauders were being lowered out of windows on ropes. These were the Theodore Roosevelt children. On another occasion, after he lost the sight of one eye from a boxing with people such as John L. Sullivan, said I realized that it was inappropriate for a president to be engaged in boxing. So I've taken up jujitsu.
So meanwhile, he in between bouts and games, he sort of recognizes this idea that the 99% have some demands of the 1%. So is that another way to remember TR? Recognizing class?
Yes. When I was a graduate student at Columbia, it was all of us scoffed at Theodore Roosevelt, regarded him as something of a faker, as a reformer. We rejoiced in telling one another that William Howard Taft, his successor, supposedly a conservative, had actually broken up more trusts than the trust buster Teddy Roosevelt had. And it's taken a number of years, but then I've had a number of years to recover from that graduate student fantasy and realize how much, in fact, he did. He was really the first American president who saw that there was a public interest that was not identical with that of capital. And he intervened in the miner strike for the first time that a president had done that, not in order to crush the strike, but in order to see that union the coal miners were granted a fair treatment. He surely was not radical, and he detested radicals. He wanted above all to maintain public order, but to do so, he thought, as Harold's question indicates, that it was necessary to recognize that those who were not well off needed a friend in the White House as well as those who were more prosperous.
We can't spend too much time on Taft because you've taken care of him a bit here, but you mentioned, and I wonder how seriously you take it, in that Roosevelt might have done fatal injury to whatever reputation Taft could have left office with because of the 1912 challenge. So is that, do you think that his overreach or his reach for a third term, non-consecutive third term, injured Taft's reputation?
Oh, I do. And they were once great good friends. Taft was Theodore Roosevelt's protege. That's how he got the Republican nomination in 1908. But by 1912, when Teddy Roosevelt runs on a third-party ticket, they are calling one another a series of names, including Fathead. Taft was not nearly the conservative he is often depicted as being. There were a number of pieces of progressive legislation that he advocated, but he was never really comfortable in the role of president. He thought, he once said that my idea of the closest approximation to heaven is a court. And he had to be pushed by his wife into accepting the presidential nomination. His wife, incidentally, as first lady, was responsible for the introduction of cherry trees to Washington, one of the memorable contributions of the Taft years. And when he was named Chief Justice of the United States in the 1920s, then he felt that he was in his element. I should say one other thing about Taft. As you see, this is a very large book, and I've been getting a lot of teasing about the length of the book. We spend, Jean Ann and I spend our summers in Maine, and we have a friend there who had been a gag writer for Bob Hope, and he wrote me a nice letter about the book, but he said he had read it on Kindle. And why didn't he read it in this version? He said because his doctor had instructed him never to lift anything heavier than William Howard Taft.
You made the connection. You brought the story down. Right. Bob Hope's gag writer would be proud. So, by the way, this book has every slightly familiar, famous, perfect quote about each American president, and some that I never heard before. And I sort of love the depiction of Woodrow Wilson as an Icarus who flew too close to the sun in his ambition for world peace. But you do not spare him, even as you talk about his extraordinary domestic program, you don't spare him his hideous civil rights record or lack of it, his cracking down on dissent, more than Lincoln in a way, and without justification, perhaps. And anyway, let's talk about Wilson for a bit. I didn't know, by the way, that he grew a beard when he was a wasted man while still president.
Yeah, that's
sort of a 19th century thing.
It was a terrible experience for him after he had the stroke in the middle of trying to promote the League of Nations. When I went to New York Public Schools and the New York City High School, Newtown in Queens, Woodrow Wilson was the hero of my teachers. He was the advocate of the League of Nations. He was the figure who might have saved us from the horrors of the rise of Nazism, of the loss of life in World War II. And I started out with that assumption about it. I find that living with him year in, year out, and writing about him, he's not an easy man to find lovable. One of the journalists of the period, Henry Stoddard, wrote that when I think of Theodore Roosevelt, I think of a Franz Hals, a robust figure with a lot of color. When I think of Woodrow Wilson, I think of a steel engraving. And I think that comparison is apt.
But I mean, his is a name we practically can't speak in academia as Princeton goes through the throes of its. I guess they've settled it now, and we'll keep the name of Woodrow Wilson.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't pick up on that, Harold. Any historian who has worked on the Wilson period is astonished by all the flap at Princeton, as though this is a new revelation. We've known this for decades, more than half a century. The main biographer of Woodrow Wilson and the editor of his papers is Arthur Link, who was a professor at Princeton. And he was a considerable admirer of Woodrow Wilson. But nonetheless, he wrote a piece for American Scholar, the magazine of Phi Beta Kappa, 60 years ago maybe, pointing out the racism of Woodrow Wilson. We long believed that the racism in the District of Columbia was a result of its proximity to former Confederate states. What Link brought out is that the segregation in Washington actually begins with Woodrow Wilson, in the government departments. So I've had some praise for pointing this out in my book, but I didn't point anything out that we haven't known for more than half a century.
You say that after Wilson, the day of presidential giants passed, at least for a time.
Yeah.
And yet, I think one of the most fascinating parts of the book, as much as I hate to admit it, was your section on Warren Harding, who you note was anti-lynching, which Wilson never bothered about, hired the first, that was cool that you hired the first presidential president, pro-civil liberties, and that his wife, whose reputation is akin to that of an axe murderess at this point, a possible murderer, was a generous first lady, open, invited people in. I mean, you have painted a very new picture of Harding, and a few of the critics have pointed out that you have this interesting admiration for some aspects of his presidency.
Yeah. I don't think the Warren Harding Society is likely to invite me to their next gathering, because he doesn't come out overall very well. I start out by the chapter by noting that H.L. Mencken goes down from Baltimore to Washington to listen to Harding's inaugural address, and he writes to his friend Carl Van Doren, the biographer of Benjamin Franklin, that night, that this is the damnedest bosh even he has ever perpetrated. Was it for this that Washington's men froze at Valley Forge? And E.E. Cummings, the poet, said that Warren Gamaliel Harding, and this is a Cummings poem, and with the, you know, the way those lines run, is the only man, woman, or child who's ever written a declarative sentence with seven grammatical errors. I quite understand the point Harold is making, because I also point out that he was in many ways a warm, generous person. A single instance of this, when Eugene Debs, socialist leader, who was imprisoned for his opposition to the war in World War I. When Debs is in prison in the Atlanta penitentiary, President Wilson is asked to pardon him. And there's simply a simple line, refused WW. Harding does pardon him, and not only pardons him, but he pardons him ahead of time, so he's able to spend Christmas with his wife. And he invites him to the White House, to the Oval Office, and he gets up out of his chair, leaps up in delight, and says, "Oh, Mr. Debs, I've been so looking forward to seeing you," stretches out his hand. And Florence Harding, as you say, doesn't fare well in accounts of the Harding period. In contrast to the prison that the White House was in the last Wilson months, opens up everything, takes the curtains away from the windows, says, "Why shouldn't people look in? It's their house. Belongs to the American people." So that's a sense of Harding that I think doesn't come across in the simplistic views of his presidency.
And the reason I emphasize that, I didn't want to trivialize the deep analysis in the book, but Professor Leuchtenburg does point out throughout the book that in presidencies of people that seem less than capable in some ways, there is a great connection to the people that is an important aspect of the presidency, and you stress that throughout. We'll find out who those people are as we go along. We don't have time for Coolidge, alas. I just checked the clock. But I like that you said America traded the backroom speakeasy for a New England parlor with Coolidge. Yeah.
Well, I'll say one thing, Harold, about Coolidge is that when I taught at Smith College more than 60 years ago, I lived down the street from Grace Coolidge. Oh. And I thought she was an absolute wonderful woman. And her husband treated her terribly, told her she couldn't smoke, told her how to dress, told her she couldn't hold press conferences. But she had taught at the Clark School in Northampton for the deaf and dumb. So at one point, there was a gathering of reporters. And she answered their questions in sign language, obeying her husband, but still carrying on the press conference.
And she was quite a fashion plate, whatever his restrictions on her.
Yes.
Good jazz age first lady. Mr. Hoover, maybe no one more qualified on paper to be president of the United States. You call him a humanitarian who lacked humanity. So why would a man as well-trained, well-schooled, experienced, fail to grasp the challenge that faced him, just completely fail to grasp that some kind of government intervention and compassion was necessary to confront the Depression?
I start out by saying that contrary to Hoover's reputation, he actually at the outset did more than any predecessor had done to deal with the unemployment, deal with the Depression, much more than Cleveland had in the panic of 1893, or had Van Buren had done in the panic of 1837. He did take a number of steps at the outset, but then quickly stopped short. I wrote this book because I was asked to do so by the Annenberg Foundation a dozen years ago or so. But I couldn't get to it right away because I was finishing one book, and Arthur Schlesinger had asked me to write a biography of Herbert Hoover, a short biography, which I did for Times Books. And at the conclusion of that biography, I quoted someone as saying, and I agreed with the quotation, that Herbert Hoover had saved more lives than anybody else in the history of the world. He was fiercely anti-Bolshevik, but his intervention in Russia in the 1820s was praised by Maxim Gorky for the numbers of thousands of lives of women, children, others that he had saved in Russia. He first developed a large reputation in government as food administrator in World War I. And somehow he convinced himself that everything that he had achieved as food administrator, later as Secretary of Commerce, was a result of voluntarism, and developed a fierce dislike for government coercion. And he persuaded himself in the Great Depression that a voluntary action by good-willed people was going to suffice. Even when the heads of the Unemployment Relief Commissions he had appointed told him that people were literally starving to death, that it was impossible. Say, in a city like Toledo, 6 out of every 7 people were unemployed. There was just no prospect. There was a town called Coello in Illinois that had 1,350 people. And in that town, the total number of people employed was 2. And the possibility then that the community could rally to help out those who were jobless was simply a chimera. But Hoover held to that view to the end of his presidency.
And you describe, of course, one of the chilliest transitions in American history. And 100 pages of this 880 or so page book are devoted to FDR, of course. Yes. I'm surprised you were able to do it in 100 pages, because I don't know where to begin or how to end, but I love the reminder that when someone sidled up to Eleanor in the White House and asked, "What do you think the president thinks about this?" She said, "The president doesn't think, he decides."
Yes, yes.
And he really was the decider in your portrait. But I just want you to think for a minute and tell us what your view is, because we're in Eleanor and Franklin's house, of course. What your view of the partnership is. How broad was it, and what were the restrictions? Where did FDR close it down in terms of Eleanor's long years of influence?
Well, Doris Kearns Goodwin tells the story of Roosevelt's, President Roosevelt's, agreeing that the First Lady could leave three memos on his night table each night, but no more than three. She was a ubiquitous figure. It was said that that Admiral Byrd in the South Pole always set an extra place at dinner in case Eleanor Roosevelt dropped in. She was an extraordinary influence, particularly on behalf of civil rights, on behalf of young people, and the catchphrase that's often used is that she was his eyes and ears. She saw to it that when Walter White, the head of the NAACP, couldn't get an audience, she arranged for one, brought Walter White to the White House. That was the kind of influence that she had on the president, which was enormously important.
Do you think she also was positioning herself, or even FDR might have been positioning her, as a lightning rod on more liberal issues, particularly with race?
Well, there is a story, and Ken Burns may have used this in the Roosevelts, who I worked with him on that, he would say, "Oh, you know, it's my missus." So I said, "I can't control her. That's the way that she lives." But he knows at the same time he's glad she's saying it, because she's creating an atmosphere in which he can move more progressively than the congressional leadership wants him to.
I'm going to leave the Roosevelt part for those people who are smart enough to buy this book upstairs and read it, because I'd love to do some of the lesser known or of the presidents, and you, of course, have spent a lifetime writing about Roosevelt, and we know that. But I must say, from a personal point of view, I was deeply hurt to be reminded that one way that FDR was a greater commander-in-chief, and you've written about this, Andy Polsky has written about this, one way he was a greater commander-in-chief than my man, Mr. Lincoln, was that he picked good generals and Lincoln picked a lot of lousy generals. It's a very cruel point to make, I must say.
One of the hard things, of course, about writing about recent presidents, and I go through Bill Clinton, is that you're subject to being interrupted by the people who are still around, and more particularly by their advocates. But this is the first time I've gotten any flack from Lincoln.
By the way, all of you who are concerned about or thinking about the possibility of contested conventions in either of the political party, you should remember, as Professor Leuchtenburg reminds us, that it was FDR who got rid of the two-thirds rule for Democratic nominees in between terms, right?
It happened in the 1936 convention. He tried to do it in 1932, and there was such a backlash that he had to...
Well, the Smith people wouldn't let it happen, right? They were going to lurk for a while.
Yes. The interesting aspect of that is that in the 1912 convention, Woodrow Wilson finally got the nomination after 42 ballots, only because the man who had the majority, Champ Clark of Missouri, couldn't get the two-thirds that was required. And it was Champ Clark's son, senator from Missouri, who put through the resolution at the 1936 Democratic Convention that ended the two-thirds rule.
One aspect of the Roosevelt presidency that's not really talked about that often is his genius in converting African-American support from its longstanding loyalty to the Republican Party to the Democratic Party, loyalty which is now absolutely assumed and taken for granted in huge majorities. But African-Americans, as hard as they were hit by the Depression, which arguably is harder than white people,
yes,
still voted for Herbert Hoover in 1932 for the party of Lincoln because of what they faced in the South, of course. How on earth did he win that vote over by 1936?
Well, certainly it changes between 1932 to 1936. Roosevelt is in good part responsible for it, not because he advocated civil rights legislation, because none of it gets through in the New Deal. That doesn't happen until Truman. Although during World War II, Roosevelt does issue a Fair Employment Practices Commission order, but rather because of the disproportionate amount of relief that at a time of massive unemployment that went to African Americans. By disproportionate, I don't mean inequitable, but rather that about 10% of whites were getting relief, 25 to 30% of African Americans were, arguably not enough because they were so disadvantaged. So many more were jobless or discriminated against. And this was the changeover was first seen in the 1934 midterm elections when a black editor in Pittsburgh, a man named Robert Vann, said, "Turn Lincoln's picture to the wall. That debt has been paid in full." Black voters, as Harold said, as late as 1932, were voting for the party of the great emancipator, were voting against the party of white Southern Democrats, now had a new consideration on economic policy. And in 1936, in massive numbers, African Americans swung to the Democratic side and, as you were saying, have been there ever since. So now it's more or less 90% Democratic.
I'm one of the things that I'll just do this briefly so we can march ahead, because I do want to leave a bit of time for questions. We can go a little longer than normal if we, I don't know how close we're going to get to Bill Clinton, literally or in the discussion, but we shall see.
You are safe.
Roosevelt, you probably know this, hired Robert E. Sherwood to be his speechwriter shortly after Abe Lincoln in Illinois won the Pulitzer Prize, and he instructed Sherwood to get Lincoln into his speeches in preparation for World War II. He liked the idea that Sherwood had portrayed a Lincoln who was reluctant to fight, but knew he would have to. And that just crept into the vocabulary of, "I hate war, but," in 1940. So there is a connection, and it's nice that Roosevelt remained an admirer even as the picture was turned to the wall. It's a great metaphor. Truman, you have interesting things to say about Truman. who you call the Missouri Compromise. I love that. for vice president. You sort of lament his lack of courage against the Red Scare, the decision to invade North Korea, lackluster appointments, and an interesting point about his self-aggrandizing about his own administration later as he became a memoirist and a television personality. I remember seeing Truman on TV talking about his presidency every week. He's the first man who ever said son of a bitch on television, which I thought was, I was watching with my father, and he said, I can't believe he said that. I love that guy. But Truman, who has risen in the polls among historians, is he due for a re-revision?
Oh, I've been asked a number of times what president in the book may cause the greatest surprise, and I think it's Harry Truman, but for the contrary reason, for the number of things I point out that Truman achieved. And
I must have inferred all the negatives as I went along.
But certainly they're there. And each of the points you mention are well taken. But if one thinks of the impact he had on foreign affairs, the ending of World War II and the occupation of Germany and Japan, the Truman Doctrine, the Marshall Plan, the Berlin Airlift, NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty, the Korean War, the 0.4 program of foreign aid. It's a combination of impacts that I think are not normally recognized. And if you think of the impact that he had on civil rights, first the appointment of the President's Commission on Civil Rights, then his address to Congress.
Integration of the military.
Pardon me?
Integration.
And the desegregation of the armed forces and the intervention in amicus suits in a number of against restrictive covenants in the Supreme Court and in what became the case of Brown v. Board that struck down segregation. And then beyond all of these, the expansion of the executive office for good or ill, so many of the institutions, the Department of Defense, the CIA, the Council of Economic Advisors, the Atomic Energy Commission, all of these different branches of the executive office, they all start with Harry Truman. And I think that the overall impact of Truman is, even among historians, not as recognized as it ought to be.
And you point out that it could have gone either way. Both Lincoln and Roosevelt took a risk with their vice presidential designations in their final terms. One turned out to be a disaster for the country, and one turned out to be something of a savior. So I was trying to figure out as well if you like Ike. That was complicated as well. I'm not going to even dare to give my assessment of what you assessed, but again, I read into these litanies of the negative side of the balance sheets of all these fellows, because you do present fair pictures of each. With credentials, achievements, and also disappointments. But Eisenhower, the man who leaves something of a shambles in foreign policy and certainly doesn't strike back against McCarthyism. But I won't say anything more in analyzing your analysis. Two terms,
yes.
Also being reassessed now, and he's gaining in the historians' polls.
And well, clearly, Eisenhower was held in, it's not too strong a sense, a word to say, in contempt by a great many intellectuals when he was president. It was said that he insisted on on short memos so that his lips would not get tired. there were bumper stickers that said, if we're going to have a golfer in the White House, let's elect Ben Hogan. But in more recent years, Eisenhower's risen steadily in the estimates of historians. Last night I taped an interview for the Charlie Rose show that may be on tonight. I'm not sure, but sometime shortly. In any event. And I was asked, and not by Charlie Rose, but another CBS correspondent, what American president in the 20th century did I think was being overestimated? And of course, you have a second to answer a question of this sort. But I said Dwight Eisenhower. And it's not that I don't think there were numbers of good aspects of the Eisenhower presidency over those 8 years, because there were. But he is credited with achievements that I don't think bear close scrutiny. He is said to have been the man who, by sending troops into Little Rock, helped advance civil rights in the 1950s. In fact, Eisenhower did very little for civil rights, and even when he sent the troops into Little Rock, said, "I've never said a word to anybody about what I think about segregation." One consequence, as Harold knows, I've worked with Ken Burns for more than 30 years on his films, most recently Jackie Robinson, that was on this week, and Jackie Robinson supported Nixon in 1960, because Kennedy had said to him that being from Massachusetts, I don't know much about colored people, and Robinson said, "I thought the hell with that." It was his business to know more, but before he had that confrontation with Kennedy, he chewed out Eisenhower at a press conference when Eisenhower said colored people ought to be more patient. That drove Jackie Robinson away from Dwight Eisenhower. Similarly, on McCarthyism, it is said that he cleverly, by refusing to engage with Joe McCarthy, brought his downfall. In fact, the members of the Eisenhower administration helped carry out some of the worst excesses of McCarthyism in the first years of the Eisenhower presidency. So that briefly is my response to your question, Harold.
I'm so relieved I read one part of it correctly. That's but let's skip a little bit and talk about the vice president. He allowed to be nominated twice and didn't seem to like very much. You give a very deep, thoughtful analysis of the Nixon administration before the scandal, obviously. Just a brilliant and emotional section on the destruction, his self-destruction, but maybe the last president to have achieved great things in terms of reorganizing government, OSHA, EPA, the National Endowments for the Arts and Humanities, consumer safety, Title IX, a reassessment due there, or it's just too hard?
No, what you say is true. Most of us don't think of something like EPA as being a Nixon achievement. Similarly, one has to think twice to realize that it was
Nixon's appointees to the Supreme Court, who brought about Roe v. Wade, and a number of other of the more progressive decisions of the 1970s. It appears that what Nixon did was to allow some of his aides to have a free hand. What he said, just don't get me in any trouble. If you want to go off in some progressive direction, that's fine. There's no indication that it was ever something he cared desperately about. I have from the first in the chapter revealed what an absolutely vicious anti-Semite he was. How even to in his treatment of Kissinger, and how though he it can be said was president during these progressive developments in domestic policy. There was the movement toward a more rational view of China. Nonetheless, is always going to be remembered for the horrors of the distortion of the executive office that led to his expulsion from office. That is the real story of Nixon, much more important than any of the details of domestic or foreign policy.
So we should spend a few minutes on Ronald Reagan. I must say, the first 10 pages are amusing. I mean, I laughed aloud at some of the great stories of his, Reagan's incredible ability to appear without noise, and how did Edmund Morris describe him? If he was a stone and dropped in a well, there would be no splash. This astonishing moving through history. He had a hard time staying awake. His aides joke that there should be a sign put outside the cabinet room that said, Ronald Reagan slept here. I like that story as well. But
he even fell asleep when he was talking to the Pope, when he had an audience at the Vatican.
Long trip. My question is, and you ask the question in the book, and so I'm going to force you to answer it. You say there is a lot more to being president than policy alone, even though under his watch the federal bureaucracy grew, the national debt grew, the budget grew, he successfully redirected the culture toward conservatism. How on earth do you think he did it while not practicing it?
Well,
at least economically.
Yes. Well, let me take up the first thing you said and then that second, Harold.
Sure.
He was the hardest president to write about, save perhaps for Franklin Roosevelt in a very different way. I'd written or edited 8 books on Franklin Roosevelt, so to sit down and try this one more time and to try to say something fresh was the toughest writing assignment. But on Reagan, the hard thing to do is simply tell facts and not come across as a totally unbalanced zealot. Reagan, at one time, actually more than once, he told the story of the horror of his experience as a single corps photographer in World War II, coming upon a Nazi extermination camp. Reagan never left this country in World War II. There are so many aspects, so many times Reagan tells a story that is so palpably untrue. And I was thinking when Harold said he was going to begin at the beginning, which is a sensible way for a historian to deal, I began to write the Reagan chapter at the beginning, which is the inauguration. And in his inaugural speech, Reagan tells the story of a World War I soldier, Martin Treptow, who is buried in Arlington Cemetery as Reagan looks out toward Arlington Cemetery. And what Treptow had wrote in his diary before he was killed on the Western Front. It's a very moving story, except Treptow is buried in Wisconsin. and his aides told him this. But he didn't see any reason why a good story ought to be trumped by reality. And so I began by describing the inaugural address and then explaining that Treptow wasn't there. And I thought, if I start the chapter that way, I will lose every Reagan admirer in the first three pages. So the story is there, but I had to spin it in a different fashion. Now to the key question that Harold is asking. Almost everything that is said about Reagan, and one of the things was said by a historian on television this week, is wrong. He didn't cut down the size of the federal government. He wasn't primarily responsible for a new relationship with the Soviet Union. You could go down point after point after point. And finally, when you combine all of this with his lack of knowledge, you get an extraordinarily negative assessment of Reagan. If you leave it with that, you've missed the point. Because Reagan really created the political climate that we're living in today. Reagan had an enormous impact on American politics, on American attitude. The pro-government advocacy of Lyndon Johnson in the Great Society is something we have not been part in any significant way of American political discourse ever since. Bill Clinton became a president as a centrist Democrat. Even Fritz Mondale asked me to contribute to his acceptance address in San Francisco. And I gave him a whole series of quotations, many of them from Franklin Roosevelt. He used none of these. He used one from Harry Truman in which he says that a president has to say yes and no, but he especially has to say no, which meant that Mondale was going to be able to put down the demands of teachers' unions. He was going to balance the budget. This was the atmosphere that Reagan created in the 1980s, and is the atmosphere that we have with us today. So he is, on the one hand, the most uninformed president we have ever had, a man who is credited with a great many achievements he never achieved, but also one of the most influential presidents of the 20th century.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Clinton because it brings us to the end of the century. What I think interested me the most about the chapter, as you talk about his triangulation, you obviously talk about the impeachment proceedings, you also talk about a partnership that you say was the strongest president-first lady partnership, the most equal president-first lady partnership in American history. Do you think, in fact, that we're hearing a great deal today about how much Hillary Clinton should be held responsible for some of the initiatives that President Clinton passed through Congress, for which she is not technically responsible, but at the time may have been a partner in. Prison building, mass incarceration, things that are being questioned now. How deep was the partnership? How real was the equality of power between the First Lady and the President?
Oh, substantial. No First Lady has exercised as much power as Hillary Clinton did. There have been, we were talking earlier about Eleanor Roosevelt's influence. There have been other First Ladies who played significant roles, but no First Lady before, or one can say since, has had been part of an administrative apparatus to the extent that that Hillary Clinton was in the healthcare plan. A number of writers, my former PhD student at Columbia, William Chafe, who's written a book on Bill and Hillary, David Gergen, have said that that Hillary Clinton held Bill captive. I don't call either of them Hillary or Bill. I'm just making clear who I'm talking about. In return for her acceptance of his extramarital adventures, she demanded compensation, and that the compensation was the role that she played in the healthcare plan, which is generally regarded as disastrous. So the answer to your question is yes, I think that is a burden. Let me say, over all the years when I was a professor, which was 56 years, I always took care never to indicate my political sympathies. I have every intention of voting for Hillary Clinton in November. So I give this negative evaluation in that context. I think it's a problem for Bill Clinton, and not for Bill Clinton, but for Hillary Clinton in this campaign, the role that she had and the misfortunes that occurred in the Bill Clinton presidency.
I left out George H.W. Bush, but I will tell you that one of the best lines in the book is in briefly passing over the Bush 1 administration. You say that he was a comma between two apostrophes. So that was a deft way of handling it. Yeah. So we've taken more time than usual, but I want to give you all a chance to ask some questions. So we have microphones. Please wait for them. Yes.
I wonder if there is a Hillary presidency, whether Bill will play the same role that she played in her presidency.
Well, I think the one thing it's safe to say is that if these theories of Chafe and Gergen are right, if he does, it won't be for that reason. For the last good many years, with the expectation of that Hillary Clinton would be a presidential candidate, the jargon has been the Bill problem, and we haven't heard quite as much about it as we did a few years ago. But I suspect as the campaign heats up, there'll particularly be attempts to goad Bill. So he does have a capacity, as he showed in the campaign years ago in hurting her campaign against Obama by appearing to be racist, which he certainly is not. But he can say things that he wishes he would take back the next day. I think the question of what Bill Clinton is going to be doing over the next 4 or 8 years if she's elected is one that we're likely to hear more of in the months to come.
This lady had her hand up here. Mike is coming. It's interesting, he just had another explosive moment, but it didn't seem to matter as much as the South Carolina thing did 8 years ago. He blew up at a Black Lives Matter person, and it people sort of thought he was defending Hillary, and it was sort of nice. I don't know.
You didn't answer Mr. Holzer's question, why did Ronald Reagan have that influence that he had about changing the whole tenor of the political atmosphere in this country? Why?
I suspect that it's not a question easily answered, but there was a very strong feeling in the country before Reagan that the American presidency was in serious trouble. The beginning with the presidents elected in 1960, the first had been murdered. The second, Lyndon Johnson, had not dared run for another term. The third, Richard Nixon, had been driven out of office. Both Ford and Carter's presidency, fairly or unfairly, were regarded as failed presidencies. And there was, particularly in the part of the media, a yearning for a successful president. In 1985, for Reagan's second term, I was at the CBS anchor desk with Bill Moyers on the inauguration. I couldn't believe the Washington press. It was as though the second coming had come, and that will to believe is, I think, an important part of it. And Reagan had skilled people around him creating the image of mourning in America. After the gloom, particularly of the Carter years, that now there is a new atmosphere in the country, new possibilities for change and growth, and the figures on what actually happened on income distribution were not widely known, but that sense that this was an ebullient president who was giving a sense of cheer and hope to the White House, to the nation, that stuck, whatever else went wrong.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Do you think that Bill Clinton's reputation among historians has declined significantly since he left office, and particularly in the last couple of years, as people are being forced to reassess his presidency in light of his wife's candidacy?
I think that Clinton was, unlike some other presidents, never a very great, did not ever have a very great following among historians. If you sit back and try to figure out what in the 8 years of Clinton's presidency were the monuments of his presidency, they're not easy to find. I was mentioning working with Ken Burns. One of the films I worked with him on was baseball. I wrote the basic workup of outline for baseball. And the premiere was at the National Theater in Washington, and the Clintons gave a great picnic on the White House lawn. The Durham Bulls came, and it was a batting cage. People walked around saying, "Beer, get your cold beer." crab cakes were distributed, and the president talked to me about another earlier book I'd written, in which he didn't come out very well. He was full of good cheer, couldn't have been pleasanter. It generally said about him, he seduces everybody he meets, man or woman. I think historians have always liked him as a person, whatever they thought about his activities, but have regarded him not as a change maker, but as a centrist that he was when he started office and when he ended. So in this House of Roosevelt, one of the main features of the first 100 days of 1933, of the separation of investment from commercial banking, ends under Clinton. There are other aspects that move in a conservative direction. So his reputation has never been exceptionally high. But to pick up on the last part of your question, I think it is probably the charm is no longer there, and the shortcomings are there, and to that extent, I think the reputation probably has declined, as you were suggesting, over the last couple of years.
Probably the next voice you hear will be the sigh of relief from Presidents Bush and Obama that Professor Leuchtenburg did not include them. The book ended in 2000. This has been absolutely fascinating, well worth the extra time we spent out of our routine a bit. I'm so thrilled that you were here. I may not survive, but I'd like to have you come back to do your next book with us. Just in case you don't know, this marvel is 93 years old, and we're so proud that you came. Thank you.
Thank you, Harold.
Please join us for a reception and a book signing upstairs.